Wall Street, central banks, and retail investors have one thing in common: their growing interest in cryptocurrencies. According to CoinShares, inflows into crypto funds and products hit a record $4.5 billion in the first quarter of this year.
There's $140 trillion of U.S. wealth, $400 trillion of global wealth. So we're now up to half a percent of global wealth is in crypto, and that's growing. I think it'll be a percent by the end of the year.
Bitcoin gets the most attention among its crypto peers, but critics of digital currencies raise concerns about their structure and their volatility.
I don't completely buy the whole thing. You're essentially saying that we're going to create a store of value and a medium of exchange around something that only exists inside of a computer somewhere.
Bitcoin is not having any income, doesn't have any users, doesn't have liquidity services, doesn't have any utility. What's the intrinsic value of it? It's just a self-fulfilling bubble.
Beyond Bitcoin, it's the underlying technology of blockchain that is attracting investor interest. According to CB Insights, startups focusing on blockchain raised about $2.5 billion in just the first quarter of this year, outpacing the amount raised in all of 2020.
What it's really doing is it's building an infrastructure to actually transact on.
Central banks are also feeling the pressure to create their own central bank digital currencies. A recent survey by the Bank for International Settlements found that 86% of central banks are currently engaged, up from 65% in 2017.
What the central bank is essentially trying to do right now is a version, a very mild version of, if you can't beat them, join them. They're almost trying to disintermediate the disintermediators.
The motivation for central banks has been partly to guard against the risk of financial exclusion or digital dollarization if payments shift to privately controlled alternatives.
I do wonder whether at this point Bitcoin should also be thought in part of as a Chinese financial weapon against the US, where it threatens fiat money, but it especially threatens the US dollar.
Marty Chavez is someone who really knows his way around blockchain and distributed ledgers. He's been part of Silicon Valley startups. He's taught the course at Stanford. He's been the CIO and then the chief financial officer of Goldman Sachs. And now he's a senior advisor at Sixth Street Partners. And he says that digital currencies may ultimately hold the key to global reserve currency dominance.
I still don't know what form exactly central bank digital currencies will take. It's not 100% clear at all that they need to be on a blockchain. They certainly need to be highly distributed, privacy protecting, and fault tolerant. There's a geopolitical overlay. So we've seen some sovereigns, such as China, very aggressively introducing a digital currency. And you know, I'm not privy to their conversations, but sure, I would love to have international trade priced in that currency as opposed to dollars. On the other hand, everybody's going to be really skeptical that maybe the surveillance of another state or sovereign attaches to someone's use of their digital currency. And so privacy protection while achieving anti-money laundering and know your client, these are all very, very difficult balances. But I'll go back to something I said 10 years ago when I was talking to one of the early Bitcoin CEOs, and I think it's related to where you started the conversation. I said 10 years ago, I am highly confident that the Fed will continue the digitization of the US dollar, and one day it will be a digitally native asset, effectively a cryptocurrency. And he said, that will never happen. And I said, well, I don't use never, and I'm sure it will happen. And there's this divide, East Coast, West Coast, the sort of a little bit of thinking in Silicon Valley that those people in New York and DC will never figure it out. They will figure it out.
Well, one of the things that I'm curious about is we tend to think of cryptocurrency. We all think about Bitcoin because it got there first and has the biggest name as sort of a way of speculating and developing assets and value and things like that. There's another possible use here, as I understand it, which is to really redo our payment system. We actually had Chair Powell say, you know, one of the things we found in COVID-19 was how vulnerable our payment system is. Yeah. We have the SWIFT payment system, which is really pretty long in the tooth at this point.
Yes.
Is there a potential in the near future to basically have cryptocurrency, digital currency, whatever we call it, replace our payment system?
Yes, there absolutely is. And you can see the foreshadowing of that. I know you were watching closely during the congressional deliberations in the depths of the pandemic, and you might have remembered one version, a House version of the early stimulus bill, directed the Federal Reserve to create a digital US dollar and distribute them to Americans. And I remember thinking, that's a really great idea. Maybe I'll just sit down and code that up over the weekend. Right? The point is that is a huge, huge, huge project. And there's an opportunity, both for wholesale and retail, to continue modernizing the payment system. We've been electronified and digitized for a long time. Your bank account is an entirely digital construct. The question is, do we want it to be account-based? Do we want it to be like the paper dollar bills we have, except it's a digital token? These are all topics that are very actively being debated right now.
And what role do we want the regulators to have, the Federal Reserve or other central banks to have or not? Because we have digital dollars, I guess we could call them right now, because there are cryptocurrencies that are tied, specifically like Tether, to the U.S. dollar. So those are like digital dollars. That's different from the central bank, though, actually creating these. Is that right?
Absolutely. I start off old school a little bit, even though I grew up in Silicon Valley, as an extreme skeptic of stable coins. To me, stable coins are stable until they're not, just like any currency peg that ever existed. I remember when the Argentine peso was pegged to the dollar, and it was great. You could choose at the ATM. And it depended on a currency board doing what they said they were going to do, to keep that one for one. And that's the challenge with all of these stable coins. And so I think there is a necessity, absolutely, for there really to be a digital dollar, meaning it is a claim on the United States of America and simultaneously on the Federal Reserve, not something that's close to that. I think it is inevitable that we will get there. And I would not dismiss the power of the sovereign, right? Go back and read your political science, right? The Leviathan, sovereign can demand that you pay your taxes in the currency that it issues. And that's what breaks the circularity of fiat currency.
Yeah, look at Henry VIII or Elizabeth I. Yeah, it didn't work very well when they went up against the sovereign. But you said there's a necessity. Is there an urgency? You mentioned China before, and I have read that China is really pressing hard. They've essentially, I think, eliminated the ability for private parties to buy Bitcoin in China, but they are pressing hard on a central bank digital currency.
Yes.
Does that put pressure on us to compete with China on that?
Well, there have been a lot of conversations on this topic. And look, I will just give you a point of view. And as I said, I'm obviously not privy to the conversations inside the Chinese government. But if I were thinking about it from their perspective, and I assume they are thinking of all these things, I'd say, okay, we have a closed capital account. On the other hand, what if international trade could all be priced in yuan and everything exchanged frictionless in exchange for digital yuan? Maybe I would open up the capital account. Oh, well, then will people actually hold the digital yuan? Well, I'd have to get them really comfortable on privacy, and it can't just be trust us. It would have to be mathematically, cryptographically guaranteed privacy. And so you can be absolutely sure that these conversations are happening.